be servants to one another, making your kingdom come. Christ be your light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ be your light, shine in your church, gather today.
Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins. Jesus said, the first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is the only Lord. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no greater commandment than these. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. God of all mercy, we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness in each other, in ourselves, and in the world you have created. We repent of the evil that enslaves us, the evil we have done. And the evil done on our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love and serve only your will. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious Father, whose blessed Son, Jesus Christ, came down from heaven to be the true bread which gives life to the world, evermore give us this bread, that he may live in us and we in him, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Reading from Numbers. From Mount Hor, the Israelites set out by way of the Red Sea to go round the land of Edom. But the people became impatient on the way. The people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and we detest this miserable food. Then the Lord sent poisonous serpents among the people. They bit the people so that many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord to take away the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people. The Lord said to Moses, "Make a poisonous serpent. Set it on a pole. Everyone who is bitten shall look at it and live." So Moses made a serpent of bronze, put it on a pole, and whenever a serpent bit someone, that person would look at the serpent of bronze and live. The word of the Lord. We'll continue and pray Psalm 107. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endures forever. Let all those whom the Lord has redeemed proclaim that he redeemed them from the hand of the foe. He gathered them out of the land, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. Some were fools and took to rebellious ways. They were afflicted because of their sins. They abhorred all manner of food and drew near to death's door. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He sent forth his word and healed them, saved them from the grave. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his mercy and the wonders he does for his children. Let them offer a sacrifice of thanksgiving and tell of his acts with joyous shouts.
Praise and honor to you, O Lord, O Lord. Praise and honor to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Jesus said, "Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and the people love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Grace and peace to you from our Savior, Jesus Christ. Good morning. My name is Ryan Heckman. I am a friend of Reverend Charlotte, and I'm also a future seminarian. You may recognize me from several months ago. I was here in October to preach from this very same spot, and I am so thankful that I was invited back this Sunday to be with you. It's really great to be beaming into your living rooms, your kitchens, possibly your bedrooms, wherever you are finding the peace of Christ this morning. Who has ever heard the phrase, "Once you've seen something, you can't unsee it"? Go ahead, I know I can't hear you, but answer. It's a phrase that seems a little obvious, right? Of course, once you see something, it's not just going to disappear. The phrase became familiar to me when I was working for a foundation in Minneapolis, Minnesota called Headwaters Foundation for Justice. It was used when someone on staff experienced an injustice or heard a story of someone who experienced an injustice in our community. A member of the staff would describe what they saw or the story they had heard. They would describe the injustice of the situation, and then another staff person would comment, "Once you've seen it, you can't unsee it." It was our way of managing the stress we felt when working alongside parts of the community in the Twin Cities that had been systemically or systematically left behind. It was a way to put the story or experience into a brain space that allowed us to hold on to it for motivation in our work, but also as a way to sort of throw up our hands and say, yep, it's happening, it's always happening, and that's why we're here, being the only foundation in the area, working hard and funding people who are trying to change the systems that allow for that injustice. In this Lenten season, I've been thinking a lot about the many things we can't unsee from this year of two pandemics. The first, of course, being COVID-19, and the second, the injustices our society caused by racism. Lent is a season where we as Christian community grapple with what it means to be contrite. We grapple with confession, as we just did this morning in our confession. And we grapple with the many ways that we can choose to repent or turn away from and change our ways. As spring seems to have sprung, at least fleetingly, this week, and the clocks have changed this morning, I do feel like we are on the cusp of a new world, a new way of being, almost a new modus operandi. And I think John wrote especially for times where we find ourselves on the boundary of what was and what will be. We've encountered today a reference to Numbers when Jesus says the Son of Man being lifted up. Just as we heard in the book of Numbers this morning, Moses was commanded by God to make a snake statue. Moses did this as the people were being ravaged by a plague of poisonous snakes as they were once again complaining about the hardships of the desert after the exodus from Egypt. God says to Moses that anyone bitten by a snake can look at the bronze serpent and be healed. The snake is lifted up on a pole, and those who are afflicted look at this reminder of God, a physical act of repenting from sin, and then God heals. I think Jesus quoting this passage from Numbers right away in John 3 is a direct reference to his ultimate fate and our new Easter reality that we are looking forward to celebrating in just a few short weeks. Reverend Caroline Lewis, a professor at Luther Seminary, where I will be attending, reminds us that this image of Jesus being lifted up is not just limited to the cross on Good Friday, but it also references the resurrection on Easter morning and the ascension of Jesus to God, the three times that we hear of Jesus being lifted up. That in that act of Christ's ascension to God, we are put in right relationship with God, for God so loved the world that God put into motion Jesus' ministry, his death, his resurrection, and his ascension, so that we may have eternal life. Wow, what a promise. That, my friends, is the new covenant. We've been freed. Our deep relationship, our covenant with God, is promised forever and ever. Amen. In Christ's death, resurrection, and ascension, death has no grip anymore. In Christ, sadness has no more ability to hold us down. Jesus Christ, the light of the world, is shining a new, warm, sunshine-like light on the world in this promise. But if these promises are a little hard to understand or even to believe right now, I'm right there with you. It's been quite a year. In fact, just a couple of verses before our passage for today, Nicodemus, a Pharisee, a scriptural and theological authority of the time, doesn't really get it either. We all know that death still happens, suffering still exists, COVID-19 will continue to be with us, injustices and racism still permeate our society. Enter from stage right our Lenten practices of contrition, confession, and repentance. spiritual practices we are given to continue to choose Jesus, the light of the world and relationship with God, rather than the unknown darkness and gloom of not being in relationship with God. We have these tools to put into practice as we hear of this week's preparation of trial procedures for Derek Chauvin to try him for the murder of George Floyd. Minneapolis is my hometown, and it's again waiting in fear and in hope for the outcome of this trial. Indeed, cities and towns across the nation saw some protests again rightfully demanding justice this week. People in my hometown are preparing for a man who was literally recorded killing another man to get the minimum sentence or possibly no sentence at all. Parts of the city are again boarding up for an outpouring of anger and rage at several systems that allow for this possibility to be real. In the days following the outpouring of anger across the country after George Floyd's murder, I saw a video of Kim Jones, who is an author and screenwriter of color, who used the game Monopoly as an analogy to show why the anger was unleashed across our country in the form of uprisings. This is in part what she says. Quote, "For 400 rounds of Monopoly, you don't get to play at all. Not only do you not get to play, you have to play on behalf of the person you're playing against. You have to earn money and wealth from them, and then you have to turn it all over to them. Then, for 50 rounds, you finally get a little bit, and you're allowed to play. But anytime your opponents don't like the way that you're playing, or if you're catching up, or if you're doing something to be self-sufficient, they burn your game." "How can you win?" Jones continues. "You can't win. So when they say, 'Why did you burn down your neighborhood? Why did you burn down the community?' Well, it's not ours. We don't own anything." That Monopoly metaphor Jones uses puts so much of the hurt and anger that was felt and manifested across our country in the form of uprisings into a very stark perspective for me. In this metaphor, my eyes were opened to the fact that people have experienced harm at the hands of an economic system that has helped me and my family so much. Predominantly, people of color have suffered in the name of protecting this economic system. Economic rules like homesteading, in my case, jump-started my family's acquisition of wealth during the same period of time that Black people were enslaved and Native people were systematically killed in Minnesota by the gallows for trying to defend their holy lands from homesteaders. Our country continues to use violence to protect our economy and other systems. George Floyd was murdered for using a counterfeit $20 bill. Once I've seen it, I can't unsee it. The Gospel of John uses light and darkness to symbolize the presence, or light, or absence, darkness of God. Throughout the Gospels, Jesus is shown to be the light. John calls Jesus Christ the light of the world. I think the light of Christ has the power, like a 1,000-watt light bulb, to expose truth all around him. I don't think the truths that we see in the light of Christ will always be beautiful, though. The truths I just shared about myself are some of the ugliest truths I have to face. This year, Christ, the light of the world, has shined a light on many truths. Truths about our economy, about our health care system in the face of pandemic, truths about race and racism. Now that we've seen these truths, we can't unsee them. So I hope and I believe we are on the cusp of a new world. We've reached a turning point. A new modus operandi is emerging. We're on the journey of the cross this Lent, and we know the end of the story already. Yes, Jesus dies on the cross, and that sets in motion the resurrection and the ascension. The incarnation of Jesus, Emmanuel, has come full circle. Because of these divine actions, we are in right relationship with God. And in that promise, we can use the tools we encounter mostly at Lent, contrition, repentance, and forgiveness to jumpstart the spread of God's abiding and enduring love for all creation. We must enact this new covenant in our communities. These tools are the starting point for our new modus operandi as a community and as a nation. Now it's time for the hard work. God has done so much of the work already for us in God's actions through Jesus Christ. It's time for us as people watching the trial in Minneapolis to confess our great contrition, to come to the foot of the cross this Lent and confess our sins, what has been done, and especially what has been left undone. It's time to repent, to make a 180-degree turn and change our direction completely so that we are building community based in the new covenant. Jesus has shed light, and what has been seen this year cannot be unseen. The final verse in our gospel message today reads, "Those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God." May it be so. Amen.
Let us confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, she is worshiped and glorified. She has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We come before the Son of God, crucified and risen, who eternally intercedes for us to the Father, saying, God of love, turn our hearts again. We pray for Michael, our presiding bishop, Doug, our bishop, Charlotte, Harvey, Rick, our clergy. We pray for our church community, for St. Andrew's, and at Church Without Walls, and for all of God's people and their leaders. In the diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray this morning for St. Paul's Gardener, Cathedral in the Light, Greenfield, and Chancellor of our diocese. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Anglican Church of Chile. God of love, turn our hearts again. As we survey the news of the nations, sharpen our attention to what is happening in the world around us. Help us to pray for those in authority and for the people they govern, that there may be peace between nations and neighbors. God of love, turn our hearts again. as we build relationships with those with whom we live and work, open our eyes to the presence in their lives, to your presence in their lives, and the ways we can serve you by serving them. God of love, turn our hearts again. As we see those who suffer in any way, increase our capacity to love and to pray. We offer our prayers this morning for those on our parish prayer list: Jackie, Brendan, Cindy, Justin, Amelia, Joanne, Rick, Jacqueline, Sharon, Kathy, Cindy, Bob, Janet, Jim, Lori, Chris, the Ellis family, and Joanna. We pray for all those who are suffering from the COVID virus and for those who care for them. God of love, turn our hearts again. As we say goodbye to those who have departed this life, comfort us in our grief, assuring us of your love. God of love, turn our hearts again.
God, our rock and refuge, keep us safe in your care and strengthen us with your grace, that we may pray to you faithfully and love one another boldly, following the example of Jesus, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives forever and ever. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Also with you.
Peace be with you, everyone. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to St. Andrew's on what feels like an early spring day, if I say it out loud, knock on wood. Okay, maybe it'll stick. An especially warm welcome to our guest preacher, my friend Ryan Heckman. This guy hasn't even gone to seminary yet. Pretty amazing career ahead of Ryan as he becomes a Lutheran pastor. We are so grateful for the message that you shared about when Christ's light shines on something, we can't unsee it. Thank you for your words. Some reminders of some things going on in our community: that during the season of Lent, our chapel is open from 12 to 1 for prayer and meditation Monday through Thursday. And we do have consecrated hosts that you can pick up at that time, or you can reach out to Jen and coordinate another time to pick some up that you can receive along with the live stream services over the next few weeks. I know there have been some questions coming in about reopening and getting back into the swing of things, and we do have indication that soon after Easter we should be able to do that. So look for more details from us and hold us all in your prayers as we work towards that goal. We also have a family in our community. Many of you know that Jim Danahy, our sexton, fell several weeks ago and really badly fractured his femur. We have had a meal train going for the Danahy family and heard from Melissa this week that that's just been really helpful. And so thank you to many of you who have signed up so far. There's information in the worship guide about how you can sign up to be a part of that meal train. We're hoping to extend it over the next several weeks just to support them during this time. So please, if you are able to provide a meal, even if you're not able to deliver it, but you can cook one, let us know. And we certainly have some folks who could bring it over to the Danahys, but we would love to be able to continue to support them in that way. And thank you to Peter, who's here in the sanctuary this morning, who has been filling in to keep our church beautiful in the time that Jim has been away. We really, really appreciate that. And I'm putting you right on the spot to tell you that. coming up over the next few weeks, we are hoping to do a Zoom version of our Palm Sunday Passion reading, like we did the Christmas pageant at Easter. And if you'll look in the worship guide, there's information on how you can sign up. We'll have a rehearsal next week at 7 on March 17th, and then we hope to record on the 21st at 3 p.m. And so that way we could have many voices fill the sanctuary and your screens for that worship on Palm Sunday. We're also doing the Maundy Thursday overnight vigil, not here in the church, but for inviting anyone to do that at home. There are still some times available to sign up to sit awake with Jesus for 1 hour as that request is made in the Garden of Gethsemane. Additionally, we're looking for your pictures from this year. We're hoping to do a slideshow in our Easter service of just all of the faces of our community and what you've been up to this year. Just pick a favorite and send it to Jen, and we'd love to see your face and just remember who it is that we are, that we celebrate as a part of this community, and show us just what you've been up to in this last year, since many of us have not seen one another. And then this Thursday, we are hoping to do the first meeting of the Grief and Grace Support Group. We had the first meeting of the caregiver support group last week, and it was a really wonderful conversation. Those are open and ongoing once a month, and so if you would ever like to join, please let me know. As these are just getting started, if you would like to be a part of them, but the time doesn't work for you, let me know, and that could potentially be changed. We just are hoping to create some spaces to support the people in our community who are caring for loved ones or who have lost loved ones. To connect us all to each other. All right, I've told you a lot of things. Episcopal 101 happening this afternoon. If you want to learn about sacraments and spirituality, jump on. And Tackling Evil on Wednesday. Those are our ongoing Lenten formation opportunities. So lots more in your worship guide. Contact me if you have any questions about it. Walk in love, as Christ first loved us and gave himself for us as an offering and sacrifice to God. Thank you. All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. Amen. Our service continues with the celebration of the great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that fervent in prayer and in works of mercy, and renewed by your word and sacraments, they may come to the fullness of grace, which you have prepared for those who love you. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Let us pray. Loving God, we give you thanks for restoring us in your image and nourishing us with spiritual food in the sacrament of Christ's body and blood. Now send us forth a people forgiven, healed, renewed, that we may proclaim your love to the world and continue in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. Life is short, and we do not have too much time to gladden the hearts of those who travel the way with us. So be swift to love. Make haste to be kind. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but thou art mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand. Bread of heaven, bread of heaven, feed me now and evermore. Feed me now and evermore. Open now the crystal fountain whence the healing stream doth flow. Let the fire and cloudy pillar lead me all my journey through. Strong deliverer, strong deliverer, be thou still my strength and shield. Be thou still my strength and shield.
This service has ended. Our service in the world begins. Strive to do what God requires of us. Do justice, love kindness, walk humbly with our God. Thanks be to God.